What's up, guys? I'm Dave Klein. Today, we're going to talk about the sunken and abandoned city, filled with poison and traps abound, a king whose worship and beliefs would turn to nothing. It's time to talk about Shulva and the Sunken King. Legend has it that in the deepest reaches of the Black Gulch, behind a door locked from the inside, is a magnificent city built for a great sleeping dragon. In ancient times, people worshipped dragons throughout the various lands that inhabited Drangleic. We find multiple reliefs depicting people praying to the dragons, one in the Shrine of Winter, another at the Dragon Shrine beyond Aldia's Keep, and yet another one deep within Shulva, the Sanctum City. The Sunken King was one such worshipper of the dragons. Beyond the Black Gulch slept Sin the Dragon, who slept in the lowermost depths of the land. The king erected the eternal sanctum below the earth to worship the great dragon. He erected a magnificent city, and the dragon slept soundly. His followers were sanctum knights, soldiers, and priestesses. The priestesses sang to preserve the dragon's deep slumber, but one wonders if a single phrase of their song ever reached the dragon's ears. And his knights were guardians who were sentenced to eternal stewardship of the sanctum in clandestine ritual. For a time, a society thrived and existed within the sanctum. This society was focused on rituals to worship Sin and were known for their highly advanced craftsmanship. This showed in the Puzzling Sword, a sword crafted with rare magnetic stones of remarkable strength. The development of sorceries was stunted in Shulva, as they were considered taboo. Even so, there were some occasional gems created by a group of nameless enthusiasts. As it was the Sanctum City, and Sanctum meaning a sacred place, especially a shrine within a temple or church, the majority of their buildings were created with the sole purpose of worshipping Sin, with structures including the Dragon Sanctum, Tower of Prayer, and Priestess's Chamber. And all was good in Shulva, until the arrival of Jorgen as Drakeblood Knights. Like the others, they too worshipped the dragons, but they had a different belief, one focused on blood. The Drakeblood Knights came from a land long forgotten, and worshipped the blood of dragons. They were led by Sir Jorgen as Siege of the Eternal Sanctum. To the Drakeblood Knights, fresh dragon blood was sacrosanct. They believed that by obtaining it, they could achieve a true understanding of life, transcending their own banal existence. In a way, the Drakeblood Knight's purpose seemed to mirror that of Aldia's, the quest for knowledge beyond their own life, the quest to find the secret to the dragon's everlasting existence. Jorgen and his knights invaded Shulva and sought the blood of the dragon Sin. In their invasion, Jorg succeeded in murdering the Sunken King, and when Sir Jorg faced Sin, the slumbering dragon, he drew blood with a flash of his steel. But Sin responded by spewing forth the poison that had long brewed within him, blanketing the city in a miasmic cloud. The poisonous fog blanketed the city in death, and Sir Jorg disappeared into the Eternal Sanctum, his decrepit corpse found within Sin's chamber. With Sin awake, the Drakeblood Knights became stuck in the Sanctum and were poisoned with the rest. Sin could bear its store of poison no longer. The rain of death toppled the city, but restored the dragon's purity. The poison was so potent that it leaked out as far as into the Black Gulch. And while it's not a fact, there's a possibility that it affected a nearby water source, one in Harvest Valley, and was what eventually poisoned Mytha, the Baneful Queen. But that's pure speculation. The Sunken King and his people were left forever poisoned in their foolery, as a race that discovered a dragon, worshipped its magnificence, and perished by its side. And today, no one even remembers the king's name. But there seems to be more to the equation. The question remains, what Alana, the Squalid Queen's involvement was. Squalid being showing or involving a contemptible lack of moral standards. Alana was a child of dark, and when the abyss dissipated, the things that called it home were fragmented and scattered across the realm. Eventually, these pieces regained form in ways that hinted at humanity's true nature, which would seem to imply that humanity's true nature is to be squalid and contains an insatiable lust for strength. Like Nashandra, Alana is also a fragment of Manus' soul. Alana rests beside the sleeping dragon of the Eternal Sanctum. This child of dark accompanies the dragon, slowly amassing souls in anticipation of the coming day of vengeance. But the question arises, When did Alana come to the shrine, and how did she survive? Alana is the squalid queen, implying she was likely married to the sunken king. If so, it's possible that she was the one who tempted and convinced the king to build the sanctum, so she herself could draw energy from it. Yet, how was she spared the onslaught of destruction from Sin? That brings the possibility she arrived after the destruction of the land, so she could leech from the dead. Another thing worth noting is that she summons a warrior resembling Velstat, who gave himself to King Vendrick in both life and death. According to Velstat's soul, he was always at the king's side, as if he were his lord's own shadow. After the king retired to the undead crypt, Velstat followed, never to return. The interesting dialogue here being his lord's own shadow. So considering Alana, a dark being and another fragment of Manus, can summon Velstat, this could indicate there's a darker purpose behind Velstat. Alternatively, she also summons the dead, so it's possible she can simply control other dead beings. There lies another alternative. Raime and Velstat were known as the left and right arms of King Vendrick until their wills clashed and Raime was deemed a traitor. Another possibility being, this enemy who resembles Velstat could be Raime. In the end, a few questions still remain. Was the Sunken King tempted by Alana to create the Sanctum City, or was it of his own free will? And who was this Sunken King whose name no one remembers? Alright guys, that wraps up this Dark Souls 2 DLC lore video. Perhaps some of these questions will be answered in future DLCs to come. But until then, who do you think the Sunken King is, if it even matters anymore? What do you think Alana's involvement was, and what did you take away from the warrior resembling Velstat? And speaking of Fragments of Manus, my buddy Terramantis did a fantastic video on Nishandra I highly recommend. Also, the badass rendition of Passage for a Monk from King's Field was remixed by none other than Hellkite Drake. For more Dark Souls 2 lore videos, make sure to check out my Dark Souls 2 lore playlist. And hey, I have a new show! A super show! Check it out for some fun times! Alright, I'll see you guys next time. Peace.